we talked about finite differences. We have very simple formula to approximate the partial derivative of a function numerically. And we did a finite difference approximation of the partial derivative of the exponential function. So this finite difference here is actually approximating d by dx of the exponential function of x at x equals zero. And we know that the solution of this is equal to one, yeah, exponential of zero. And then we just plotted the error for very small shift sizes. So you see the shift here is on a log scale 10 to the minus, and then here these numbers, yes, minus 15 and so on. And there's in this picture, there's one additional point I want to show you. So now here I like to show you one additional point, which is here the orange line. Yeah. So we already recognized that the points where this approximation here is correct are the points since exponential of h is approximately 1 plus h. Yeah. So you see 1 plus h minus 1 is h divided by h. These are the points where I have no rounding in exponential of h. And these are the points where h is exactly 1 divided by 2p or 2 divided by 2 to the power of p, 2 to the power of p. So which is exactly a floating point number. So these are the points where h is exactly such a floating point number on this scale here. Then we have no rounding. And here the orange points are the ones where we have rounding. So these are the points which are in between. So for example, this here is the point where h is around, yeah, so approximately 1.5 1 divided by 2p. Yeah, so it's just in between this point. And maybe in our little test program, I like to calculate this additional point. So you just verify that all this intuition which we now have is correct. So let's calculate here 1.5 divided by 2 to the power of 52. Yeah, so times 2 to the power of minus 52. And let's calculate this. And you see, for this guy here, which is 2 to the power of minus 52, the approximation is correct. Yeah, it's 1. And for that guy here, it's wrong. And we have an approximation error, which is 0.3. Yeah? So, and just verify that you see this is exactly what we see here in this picture. So the approximation error here is 0.3, yeah, so 3 times 10 to the minus 1. Okay, so that was just another remark here on this picture. And you see very small shift sizes are a problem. And now it's the question, what is the optimal choice for this shift? So we will derive some error estimates for the finite difference approximation. And since these are just estimates, I do not give you the optimal choice for the shift size, the true optimum, but I give you the optimal shift size for the bound, for the error bound, which we derive. And hopefully this is also then a very good choice already. So let's derive some error bounds. Okay, so I'm looking for a good shift size for the finite difference approximation. So within a certain interval, so assume there is some h max, and we are looking to find a finite difference shift age between 0 and age max, yeah, so not too small. So I limit myself on this age max. So I know from the Taylor expansion that the remainder of the Taylor expansion is for the first order finite forward finite differences, it is given by the second derivative at a point xi, where xi is now in the interval from minus h max to x minus h max to x plus h max. Okay, since we just use forward finite differences, it's actually between zero x and x plus h max. But later I will use the same notation also for central finite differences. So let's consider this interval. And then on this interval, we introduce some error bounds. So we have some error bounds. Let's first assume that we have an error bound on the second or a bound, yeah, not an error bound, a bound on the second derivative. So I assume some bounds. I will later also assume other bounds. So there is here in blue, I assume a bound C2. Yeah, so C2 is a bound for the second derivative of my function v at this point xi. Okay, and I will also need a bound on the function itself, which we will then call C1. Yeah, so let's call this C0. So you see zero. So this is another one here, which is C0. So C0 should be some bound for the function, which I need later. And actually, I also need a third one, which is later C3, and which is a bound on the third derivative. So we will need this later when we look at the central finite difference. Okay, so assume we have some, we know some bounds. Okay, so first from the Taylor expansion, we have an error bound on the finite difference approximation minus the true partial derivative. So we have here that the difference between the finite difference approximation and the true partial derivative is given by the second derivative at some intermediate point times h half, yeah, shift size half. So in the Taylor expansion, it was h squared half, but we divide by h. Yeah. So this is with our constant C2. This is less than C2 times h half. And this here is the error bound we obtained from the Taylor expansion. So this error bound suggests to choose h as small as possible. So now we need to check other bounds which involve the computer arithmetic. The first step I do is that we make some assumption on how accurately can we calculate the function v. And that was here in the picture the issue. You see that we had an argument h which could take many different values. And in calculating exponential of h, there was a rounding. So we couldn't very accurately calculate exponential of h. So all these green points here were actually mapped on the same result. So there was an error in the numerical calculation of exponential of h. So we assume that there is some constant alpha. And this constant alpha determines how accurate can the computer calculate the function v. So I call now v tilde the computer implementation of calculate the function v at the corresponding point. And I assume that I can calculate this up to an absolute error, alpha. So this here is the absolute error. On my two values, x and x plus h. Okay, so actually I make this assumption on the whole interval, yeah, where we look for the optimal shift size, huh? So for any such h. So if I have this bound, I can now estimate the difference between the finite differences using the true function and the finite differences using the computer implementation. Okay, and you see that this is v tilde at x plus h minus v at x plus h. So that this is an error alpha. Okay, that's this one here. And then it is actually with a minus in front, v tilde of x minus minus, yeah, but with the minus in front. So minus v of x. So this is another error alpha. So I have two alpha. And then we divide this by h. So I have two alpha divided by h. So that is the difference between the true finite difference with the mathematical function v and the computer, the true finite difference with the computer implementation v tilde. So we moved from here, the star guy which we like to approximate, to the finite difference. And now from the finite difference to the finite difference using the computer implementation. Okay, so we have another error bound here. And you see that in this error bound, h is here in the denominator. So, oops, so we like to choose h as large as possible to make the numerical error in the rounding, yeah, in the function v to v tilde smaller. Okay, and here it appears on the top. So this is a first error due to computer arithmetic. Whoops, I have this error here. So this is a first error, so approximation error. In V due to computer arithmetics. So by the way, the best thing we can expect for alpha is something like Z zero times epsilon. So you know that we have that for the normalized floating point numbers, the relative error when we round to the next floating point number is epsilon. Yeah? So epsilon is the relative error. So the machine precision, so my alpha was the absolute error. If we now assume a bound here, the C zero, for the value of our function, so for our exponential function, C zero would be around one. then we have that the best we can expect is that our absolute error is around epsilon times C0. Yeah? Epsilon is a relative error. C0 is a constant which specifies the scale of our function, and alpha is an absolute error. So there, but there is another approximation error now in our calculation. So what I have here is the numerical implementation of our function, but I use here the exact mathematical expression for performing the finite difference and divide by h. So there could be another error here in this subtraction. Yeah? So if I subtract two numbers, the result doesn't need to be a floating point number. So if I subtract two, yeah, and then there could be another rounding here. So the last step is that the result of this here is rounded again to a floating point number. And we can assume that the subtraction is implemented with exact rounding. So the largest error that can happen in this subtraction is, say, epsilon as a relative error. So it is epsilon times C0 is the largest error that can happen. So we have a last step in the calculation of our computer implemented finite difference. And this last step is that using now the computer implementation of V tilde in the finite difference will be rounded to a floating point number. So there's another error due to computer arithmetics, which is this one here. Okay, so, and this is the rounding error. Of calculation of the finite difference. Okay, so this is around the order of the function V times epsilon divided by H. So now we put all the three parts together. So the three parts are from our partial derivative, which we like to approximate, to the finite difference, the error bound obtained from the Taylor expansion. From the finite difference using the true mathematical function V to the finite difference using the computer implementation of the function V, we assume an error of alpha in V, so we have alpha divided by h. And from the finite difference expression to the rounded result of the finite difference, we have another C0 divided by h, which is the 2 times C0 divided by h, which is the scale here of this function. Yeah, at most, and times epsilon. Okay, so if I put all these three things together, then we have a single estimate for the difference between our partial derivative and our computer implementation of the finite difference, consisting of these three parts: error coming from the Taylor expansion and error coming from the approximation error in V tilde, so in the implementation of our function, and an error coming from using this function again in a finite difference. divided by h. So now I see the right-hand side as a function of h, and I try to find the smallest value of this bounding constant. Of course, this does not need to be the optimal shift size because I'm optimizing the bound and not the expression on the left-hand side. Yeah? So I'm not optimizing the expression on the left-hand side of this estimate. I'm optimizing the bound. But it's maybe a good indication where I should search or look for the optimal shift. Or if I do not have any more information, it's maybe the best shift size. So I see the right-hand side as a function of h, and now we try to minimize this. So this means that I take the differential d by dh and I set it to zero. If we differentiate this, this is 2 alpha plus epsilon c0 divided by h squared with a minus in front. And then it's plus 1/2 c2. Yeah. Okay, so I can bring the minus on the other side. So this is like this. So I multiply with h squared, I divide by 1/2 c2. So we get h squared is 4 times, yeah, divided by 1/2, 4 times alpha plus epsilon c0 divided by c2. Yeah. Take the square root, and we have found our optimal solution. Yeah, so it's the optimal h for the bound, yeah, not for the expression on the left-hand side, but maybe a good guess. Okay, so maybe we check this a little bit. Yeah. So if we use for alpha, the best we can expect, so alpha was the absolute error in in the function v, the best we can maybe expect is epsilon times c0. Yeah, epsilon is the relative machine precision. If I use this, then the formula simplifies and we get that the optimal one is square root of 8 times c0 divided by c2 times epsilon. Yeah, so here you just have another epsilon c0. So I have 2 times epsilon c0 here, and then I have 8 times c0 divided by c2 times epsilon. So now for our example, for v being the exponential function and x being 0, we have approximately c0 equal to 1. Yeah? So I need a bound for the function. So maybe you can choose 2. Yeah? And also the second derivative is also the exponential function. Yeah? So, but you have that the function and its second derivative are of the same scale. Yeah? They are in the same scale. So we have that optimal shift size in this case, where we are on the same scale with the optimal shift size in the case that the function and the second derivative are on the same scale is square root of 8 times epsilon. Okay, and for epsilon being machine precision for floating point double, which is approximately 10 to the minus 16. Yeah, so this is floating point double precision. So we find that the optimal one would be around 3, yeah, square root of 8, a little bit smaller than 3, 10 to the minus 8. So let's shortly verify that this is a good shift size. So we go back here to our program. We had a small function which actually plotted the approximation error for the finite differences. And that was our picture where we actually were looking at small shifts around 10 to the minus 14. Yeah, and these were not looking very nice. Okay, so let's search a little bit around, say, something like 6 to 10. Yeah, so 10 to the minus 6 and 10 to the minus 10. So let's have a look at this region. Yeah, and we get now this result. So you see for shifts which are around 10 to the minus 6, we get large errors which are due to the Taylor expansion remainder term. For shifts which are around 10 to the minus 9 or 10 to the minus 10, we get shifts which are noisy due to computer arithmetic rounding effects. And in between, there is a good shift, and it's 3 times 10 to the minus 8. Yeah, so it's a little bit smaller than that. So here, there's somewhere really the good or optimal shift for this. Forward finite difference. Okay. So, of course, this all here depends a little bit that we have some good bound for the function and its second derivative. Yeah? If you make this bound here larger, you will get a larger shift size, but you move away from the optimal one. And if you make this bound here larger, you will get smaller shift size, and then you will move away from the optimal one. Yeah. So actually here that I choose the constants right. Yeah. This is not arbitrary. So actually this constant here in front is the ratio between where is the scale of the function and where is the scale of the second derivative. So now I like to continue and have a look at central finite differences. So we can do the same for central finite differences, but I can be very quick here. Yeah, it's maybe everything on one slide, because now we know how this works. Okay, so for a central finite difference, we have from the Taylor expansion, this error term here. So this is the error term, or error estimate, coming from the remainder of the Taylor expansion. So we know that the finite difference is now the central one, the function v at x plus h minus the function v at x minus h divided by 2h. So this is now the finite difference. And since we could cancel the second derivative term, the remainder was the third derivative. Times h to the power of 2 divided by 6. So here I need another bound. So I already mentioned this. I need a bound for the third derivative. So assume there's now a constant c3. c3 is a bound for the third derivative on our interval where we look for the optimal shift size. And then we can bound this with c3 times h squared divided by 6. Yeah? So that is actually the only thing that changes this term. So instead of the term with c2, I now have a term with C3, a bound on the third derivative. And instead of having the h half, it now has an h squared divided by 6. There's another small change here, which is that due to the fact that I divide by 2h here in my finite difference, there's also here a 2. So there's a small other change that I divide by 2. So the difference to the previous derivation is that there's a 2 here, which will give me a 2h here. Apart from that, it's exactly the same expression. So that is the error bound coming from the computer arithmetic. So error bound on rounding errors. Okay, and I can, as before, combine the two errors to a single one. So we get that we can bound now our computer implementation approximation by the bound coming from the rounding errors plus the bound coming from the Taylor expansion. Yeah, and you see that they are just very small changes in the terms. Yeah, so we have a C3 divided by 6 here, yeah, which is different. That was a C2 divided by 2. And we have this h squared instead of an h. So now again, I try to find the minimum of the bound. Yeah? So minimize the bound. Okay, so if I differentiate this, so first, if I differentiate this, I get a minus alpha plus epsilon C0 divided by h squared plus 1 divided by 3, 2 divided by 6, C3 times h, yeah. And I look for where the derivative is 0. Okay, so now I multiply with h squared and I divide by C3 divided by 3. And we get that the optimal solution is then, okay, I have an h to the power of 3. Yeah? So we get 3 alpha plus epsilon C0 divided by C3 to the power of 1/3. Okay, so very similar derivation. Yeah, just now it's to the power of 1 divided by 3 instead of 1 divided by 2. And it's the constant C3, which is a bound on the third derivative. If we again use that the best possible approximation, so the best possible absolute error on V is machine precision times the scale of V, yeah, the relative error times C0, then this simplifies to 6 times C0 divided by 3 times epsilon to the power of 1 divided by 3. So let's also maybe check this for the exponential function. Yeah. So for exponential function around 0. Yeah. So all these guys are of the same scale. Okay, so the function, the derivative, and the second derivative, the third derivative, they are all exponential x, so they are all of the same scale. So this means the optimal one in this case is the third root of 6 times epsilon. So for our machine precision of floating point doubles, yeah, this is approximately something to the 10 to the minus 5. Okay, so we should look for the optimal shift size around 10 to the minus 5. So you see, I can use a larger shift. Yeah? 10 to the minus 8 was the one for the forward finite difference. Now 10 to the minus 5, yeah, is larger by some order of magnitudes. I can use a larger shift because the Taylor expansion error is smaller. Yeah? So the Taylor expansion error is the one which is sensitive to large shifts, is smaller. So I can use a larger shift, which is better for the numerical implementation. Let's maybe also finish this here by checking it. So we have this plot of the finite difference approximation error. So maybe let's modify this to a central finite differences. Yeah? So I modify this to a central finite difference if I take here exponential of x plus shift minus exponential of x minus shift divided by 2 times shift. Yeah. Okay, so I have just modified now my plot. So I still plot here 6 to 10 to the minus 10. Yeah. So you see big noise, yeah, here, but it's not clear where is the optimal shift size. So now look at the region which we have just derived analytically. So maybe I looked to something like 10 to the minus 4 to 10 to the minus 7. Yeah. So let's look in this region. Okay, so you see for 10 to the minus 4, we already have errors coming from the remainder of the Taylor expansion. For 10 to the minus 7, I get noise here due to numerical errors. Yeah? And around 10 to the minus 5, it appears really as if this is a good choice for the shift size. Okay, I like to conclude this discussion on what is an optimal shift size by just giving you a little bit more intuition for this formula. Okay, before all that, let's summarize the result. So we just assume some bounds, which should be as tight as possible. On the function, its second derivative and its third derivative. And I assume that we know the error for the computer implementation of the function, yeah, which is alpha. Then we can derive some nice estimates for the computer implemented finite difference approximation error for the partial derivative of v with respect to x, yeah, for one-sided finite differences and centered finite differences. Okay, on the interpretation. So from this, we see that if the second order derivative in the one-sided finite difference, yeah, forward finite difference, is much larger than the value of the function itself, then we should favor small shifts. Yeah? So we are calculating an approximation to the first derivative. If the second derivative is large, it means that the first derivative changes quickly. Okay. So then we should favor small shifts. So that's clear from this formula here, yeah? Because C2 here is in the denominator. So if C2 is large, we should favor small shifts. Conversely, if C0 is much larger, so second derivative is comparably small, we can afford large shifts, because large shifts are good for the computer implementation. Okay. Limit case, if we have a linear function, C2 is 0, yeah, then we can take a shift which is almost as large as we like. So, of course, you should avoid overflow and underflow. Yeah? So, there's also a bound in the other direction. Another nice thing which I often like to do if I derive a formula is taking a look at the units behind these objects. Yeah? What do I mean with units? So this is like in physics, yeah. So what we just did is we liked to approximate the derivative, the partial derivative, with a finite difference. Okay, and we derived that the optimal shift size is somewhere around, yeah, so I take here approximately, because we just optimized the bound, C0 divided by C2 times epsilon. Okay, when I see such a formula, and I would like to verify if the formula is reasonable, I sometimes plug in the units, the physical units of the objects, to check if this is on the right scale. Actually, you are checking a little bit the harmonic properties of the function. You are checking a little bit the homogeneousness of the function. So what do I mean with units? So if, for example, the function v has the units meters, yeah, then assume that x has the units seconds. Yeah? So actually, v maps time to space. So this has the unit seconds. Then you know that dv by dx is the velocity. dv by dx has the units meter per seconds. This is the velocity. And you also see this here, that the finite difference is a velocity, yeah? So it's a difference of meters divided by seconds. So now, what is the unit of my constant C0? C0 is a bound on the value of the function. So C0 is also a bound on how many meters can we have. Yeah? It's also a unit in meters. And C2 is a second derivative. It's second derivative of v with respect to dx squared. Yeah, so it's meters per second squared. Yeah, so it's an acceleration, you would say, in physics. Yeah, so this is meters per second squared. Okay, so what's the unit of epsilon? Epsilon is machine precision, is a relative error. So a relative error has no units. Yeah. So the unit of epsilon is just one. Yeah. So it's unitless, yeah, because it's a relative error. So now check what this h-opt is. Our h-opt is C0, which is meter, divided by C2, which is meter per second squared. So C0 divided by C2 is second squared. Yeah. times epsilon, which is unitless. So this here is a square root of second squared, which is a second. So h is a shift on x. So h is a change of the time axis. So you see that actually this formula is quite reasonable. It translates the relative error from the function, yeah, which is measured in meter, to the time axis, yeah, which is the axis for x, yeah, by using this factor here, C0 divided by C3. Okay, so I like this checking the units. Yeah, so you have maybe a little bit more intuition now for the formula. And by going back to the other formula which we had here, yeah, you see that you can do the same here. And you see this here is a meter. This is a second to the power of 3. So this here is seconds to the power of 3. Third root is again seconds. Okay, so that was it for finite differences. I have a few more plots here for our exponential function. Okay, so the as a summary, here we have the one-sided finite difference. Okay, so I plotted from 10 to the minus 1 to 10 to the minus 15. Okay, and then we zoom in from, say, something like 6, which is here, to something like 10, which is here. Okay, so that's a zoom of the scale here. Okay, and you see that the optimal shift size is maybe somewhere around here. Yeah, so h opt, which was somewhere around 10 to the minus 8. And also for the central finite difference, I have here the plot. Overall shift sizes, and we zoom in from say 4, which is here, to so we go to something like 7, yeah, so which is maybe here. Okay, so this plot here below is just a magnification of this interval. Okay, as you see, that a good choice for the shift size is like we derived. Around 10 to the minus 5, yeah, so maybe around here. Okay. Well, it's not always possible to have good values for C0, C1, C2, yeah, for the bounds of the function. And sometimes this is finding a good shift is maybe also trying around, yeah, checking the convergence or non-convergence, yeah, if you use two small shifts of your finite difference approximation. But at least the essence of this session is that you should not just use a small shift and then maybe take another smaller one, yeah, and be happy with it. Yeah, you have to be careful. There is a too small and there's a too large, and you should check this. So we just discussed first order first order partial derivatives. So approximation of first order partial derivatives. Of course, you can use all the stuff we did also for second order or higher order derivatives. I already had this very shortly on the slide, and I just want to maybe give you a very quick example. Here you see the second order derivative approximation. So what we do is we use the Taylor expansion, which was our equation, I believe, 35. We use it twice. We use it for h and minus h, and we use it for n equals 3. So we go up to order 3. So the remainder term is a remainder term in h to the power of 4. Okay, so that's our remainder. Okay, so we already did this when we derived the central finite difference. We used the same setup, but there we were subtracting the two equations. Yeah? And when we perform a subtraction of the two equations, it was that these two terms here add, because there's minus here, minus minus is plus, and these two terms here cancel. So the second derivative canceled, and we had a remainder in h to the power of 3. Now I add the two equations. So we add the two equations. So this means that here the first order term cancels because they have a different sign. Okay, and also the third order term cancels because here we have a different sign. Okay, if they are added, then from this here we get a 2v. So we have v of x plus h minus 2v of x plus v of x minus h on the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side, we have the second derivative of v with respect to x. So the guy which we would like to approximate. And this here is our approximation error. Yeah, so this is our approximation error. So actually this 2 here cancels with 2. So everything we have to do is we divide by the h squared. So then again with the mean value theorem, you can write this approximation error term with a single argument xi, and you get a nice approximation for the second derivative, which is v of x plus h minus 2 v of x plus v of x minus h divided by h squared. Actually, you see that we solve always this Taylor expansions by plugging in different values for the shift size. And you see here that if you like to calculate the first order derivative and the second order derivative at the same time, maybe you can reuse some of the evaluations of your functions v. Yeah? So you see here you need the same evaluation as we need for the central finite difference for the first order derivative. Yeah, because it was derived from the same equations, which had the same, in this case, left-hand side. So sometimes this is useful, yeah, because it can happen that in your computer the evaluation function V is expensive, and then you maybe like to reuse this. Okay, for the second order derivative and its finite difference approximation, you can also ask yourself, what is a good shift size? Actually, this is completely analogous to what we already did. Yeah? So maybe it's a nice exercise for you if you like to do this. Then that was it for today. And we start with discussing the partial derivative of Monte Carlo approximation in the next lecture. So thanks.